Good morning, namaste.
Good morning.
I'm just going to ask you to do this just because I can. So real quick, I just want you to just pull your mask down. Let me see your smile and then you can put it right back up. I haven't seen your teeth in like a year and a half, so I want to see some teeth, people. Yours too, Reg. I love you, Reggie.
I love you.
Oh, serious.
My name is Jack now. Jack O'Lantern.
You know, I can always count on you. Always count on you. Exactly. So I'm just really glad to be back, be in the park. And by the way, this is our last time in the park for a little while. We're going to take a break from the park now that we are in our new space. And if you haven't been in our new space, which I'm looking around, most of you have, you get to enjoy our amazing space. But you really can't beat this, can you? And I just remember, just really quickly, I remember when we were visioning for who Namaste was. And do you remember, for those of you that visioned, there was this one thing that was consistent with everyone. It was a lot of green. You wanted a lot of green. Now, I'm not saying you called the pandemic forth. It was money. But there was, it was trees and it was nature and this was called. And so we've had literally almost a year of being in the park every month. And I have to say, I'm really grateful to get to do that because Terry said it to me earlier, which we were talking about a national park and how you just can't ignore sort of the oneness you get in nature, right? Being out here and looking around and seeing the beautiful trees and the grass and the breeze and any minute now a plane, which is part of living in Long Beach, right? But how fortunate we are that we get to do this. I mean, we really are, and I'm just really grateful to get to do that. So before Kong plays, and he's still going to keep playing because that's what he does, we're going to have our practitioner for today, which is Nikki, come up. And are we lighting a candle or are we not lighting a candle?
Did I miss the candle?
Oh. We always walk it up. I just been, it's been a while. And Debbie Ann is our practitioner in training, and she's minister support today and just holding vigil for the service today, besides watching our precious poops. A bunch of you are, so thanks for doing that. And when I say poops, they've already owed up to that, so thanks very much. Twice, Terry says. Great. Anyway, lighting the candle, and Nikki's going to start us off with the affirmation.
That's funny. Good morning, namaste.
Morning.
Good morning.
So you cannot join me in the affirmation because we don't have a screen. So I'm going to ask you just to bring your awareness to the moment and listen with your open ears to our beautiful affirmation for the month, which says, I am cause to my own world. As my thoughts are, so is my world. I am the face of spirit releasing itself into form as blessings for myself and others. And so it is. So with that, we're going to go into our invocation and just stay in that nice, sweet space that that affirmation leads us right into. Oh, and as I listen to the birds and feel the breeze and hear the leaves and the trees and the soccer playing, I know that truly we are in the center of God. For truly it is all life, and life is the expression of the One. In, through, and as all life. So from that place of knowingness, I know then that our time in the park the service unfolds with ease and grace, and that we are truly blessed to have this time together in this magnificence, in this openness that is the truth of all life, always ever present. So it's with a grateful heart that we come together from this place of knowing, including the airplane, for that too is God. So I just say thank you for each of you, for what you bring to this service, for we cannot do this without you. We do this together. We do this as community. So as I open to that, I just know love, for that is our community of namaste. And just saying, so it is.
So it is.
Take a step up here. Morning, everybody. Take a look at the person next to you. Say, I recognize that God in you. Your voice and repeat after me. We come together. We come together. We come together. In the name of love. Come together. We come together. We come together. In the name of love. Take a look at the person next to you. Say, God loves me and I love you too. Feel the love, it's a sanctuary. Woo! Lift your voice and repeat after me. We come together. Take a look at the person next to you. Say, namaste, I bow to you.
Namaste, I bow to you.
Feel the love in the sanctuary. Now lift your voice and repeat after me. We come together.
Good morning. So my name is Shawn Mejia, and I am the Vice President on the Board of Trustees here at Namaste.
Woo! Thank you, Shawn.
You're welcome. All right, so first I'd like to do is just say thank you for joining us here this morning at the park. And now we're going to go into who we are, and please read along with me in who we are. I honor that place in you, which the entire universe dwells. I honor that place in you, which is love, truth, light, and peace. When you are in that place in you, and I am in that place in me, we recognize that we are one. Namaste. And now we're going to move on to our mission statement, and we'll just wait a few seconds here and we can get Reggie to bring that card up so we can all read it together.
Turn the letter over.
All right, so read with me our mission. I learn practical science of mind tools
and practice in a loving, connective, and vibrant community to reveal my power and change my life.
And how do we change our life? We awaken to a new truth in our lives. We realize that truth has, how that truth has played out in our lives. We take that new knowledge and transform our lives. We repeat the process in our lives in new ways. Our power statements. We are a thriving, dynamic, spiritual community. We are Namaste. This stuff works. And on to some announcements for this week. So remember that you can find all of our announcements on Facebook, our website, and also through our weekly newsletter. So this week, come join us in the experience the joy of creation through art play. The Circle is hosting Lita Martin, practitioner, and is hosted by our very own Valerie Day, practitioner, on Wednesday. Wednesday the 18th at 7 p.m. You can register on Eventbrite. The choir, we believe we have found a new director, so stand by for that information, so more information to come. And don't forget to get your weekly dose of support Monday through Friday. Start your weekday off with prayer support connection at 7 a.m. Try it out and see how your day changes. Thank you so much. Have a wonderful rest of your day, and we'll see you back in the sanctuary or at the center.
Only love. caught it. Thank you.
Thank you, Tom. Good morning, everybody. So, normally after that beautiful tone-setting song, I would take you into meditation, but we're going to do things just a little bit different today. I don't know if any of you noticed what the theme for the day was, but it is a playful pause. So, I'm going to talk first, and then we're going to do a little different meditation today. So, you know, I work out the practitioner schedule for all of us and what duties we have and when, and I never look at what the themes are when I'm scheduling people. But I have to say that I think truly God's hand was at work here when I got to be the practitioner on platform for a playful pause. If you don't know me, you may not know that play is my middle name. But the other thing about me is I also take responsibility very seriously. So sometimes I need to be reminded to pause and take some time out to play. Now, it doesn't take a lot to have me shift gears, but sometimes I do need the reminder. I don't know if anybody else can relate to that, but as I was thinking about really what play means to me, it really is that place where I connect at a heart level to the joy of my life in whatever the activity is that I'm doing. Now, like as a kid, play for me was running outside, playing games with my friends, playing sports. But now as an adult, play has a lot of different meaning for me. It is that time where I get to surrender that idea of responsibility or the idea of work. Because play can take on even cooking or baking or time with friends or doing a solitary activity that's creative. It doesn't have to be something that I'm engaging with anybody else. Where before, as a child, my child mind, play needed to be, you know, a little more active. But fun. Play for me is fun. It is that place where I connect with that childlike energy. And again, it doesn't have to be from the child's mind, but sometimes it's about approaching something for me in a new way or in a new light. Like as a child too, a lot of times I would not do something because I had the idea that in order to do it, I had to do it right. I had to be perfect at it. Well, how can I be perfect at something I've never tried, right? But now as an adult, I get that is not how I need to do anything. I get to just try it. I get to play. It doesn't matter how it looks or how it comes out. It's how am I being in the activity? How am I connecting to that joy of my life? Am I camping? Am I taking a walk? Am I running down the street? How is it looking? Because for me, it is really about connecting to that playfulness in the moment. It doesn't have to be planned. It doesn't have to be structured or organized. In fact, sometimes for me, that's better because again, that structure, that organized, that goes along with my responsibility and my work ethic, and things need to look a certain way. When I am playful, things don't have to look any way except how it looks in the moment. And that's surrender. And that's trust. And that opens my heart when I can allow that just to be. So for today, oh, and by the way, if you haven't heard, Susie and I have two brand new puppies. 4 months old and 3 months old. And if you don't think that I get regular reminders, the importance of taking the playful pause. Because I, again, in my responsibility, I get structured. Okay, right now I have allotted this amount of time. I am doing this task right now. And having puppies around, nipping at my feet or barking at me or bringing me a toy is the best reminder that whatever the task was that I had set up for myself can certainly wait for a moment while I play with my puppies and get puppy kisses. And the truth is it doesn't have to be a long ordeal. You know, play can be a 5-minute thing because with puppies, they play and then they sleep and it's that quick. And sometimes that's all I need too, is to set down the task for a minute and take a pause and come back to that place of surrender and joy. Or sometimes it may even be a reminder about what I'm doing. I may be playing in the moment and baking, and then I get into that mindset about it has to look a certain way. But if I pause for a minute and remember the joy that I am doing this for, why am I doing this? Then all that other stuff, all that other mind chatter can just go away and I come back to the play. So I believe you all have a piece of paper. And for those of you at home that are watching this, quickly pause the video and go get a piece of paper and join us. Sean, you need a piece of paper? Okay, does everybody have one? Sean, you need another one? Okay. Okay, so as we do this, I'm gonna have you listen to my instructions. But I want you just to kind of bring yourself first and foremost just to the moment, okay? Anything that may be going on in your head, just let it go. It will be there to pick up again, okay? Bring your awareness and follow my instructions. So I'm going to ask you to fold the paper in half lengthwise. Matching up the corners. Making this long rectangle. Okay. Everybody got that? Now you're going to open it up facing you so the crease is, so you got like a little valley towards you. Now you're going to take the upper right hand corner and fold it into the center. So it looks like this. And do the same thing on the other side. And again, as you're doing this, let go of any expectations that you have about what it should look like or what it should be. Okay. Now, take and fold it backwards along the center crease that you already folded so that the sides meet again, but on the other side, so your triangles that you formed are on the outside. Anybody getting an idea what we're building here?
I'm still waiting.
Now, take one side and fold it all the way down to that center fold, the whole length that you've got. So it's going to look like this. Okay. When you have that done, do the other side, because, you know, we want to be balanced. We want symmetry. And if you want to do a little extra, take this flap and fold it up back to the top center. Fold it out so you got a little flap. Do that on both sides. Now we're not going to set these off yet, okay? This is how mine looks. Yours may look similar, but it's not going to be exact, right? Because we each bring our own sense of self to this. There's nothing right or wrong. It is how you made it. Okay? And now before we go any further, though, I want you to just kind of bring your awareness to your plane. Get quiet again. And we're going to think about that initial center fold that we made. And bring your awareness to your heart, knowing that as you made that center fold, you're going to bring your awareness to your center right now. And each fold was a part of yourself that you allowed to open up and make. Now, some of you, as you did this, may be judging your plane, or judging how you did it, or judging that you weren't, your plane doesn't look right, or that you don't play enough, or whatever limiting belief or idea came forward for you. I want you to take that and put it in your plane. Just let it become a passenger. Make sure that you buckle it in. Make sure that seat is upright, that the tray table's locked in. Because those limiting beliefs are not the truth of us. We get to surrender those ideas. So on the count of three, we are going to take our planes and we're going to release whatever those ideas were or whatever judgments we held. And we're going to let them soar with the plane and be gone, knowing that we can release them that easily. Okay, so on the count of three, one, two, three. Oh, nice one. So the other thing I'm going to invite you to do is find your plane. We can find it at the end of service, or if you know where it landed, pick it up. But I'm going to invite you to take them home. They are plain white paper for a reason. I invite you to take them home and decorate them, color them, paint them, put stickers on them, whatever it is, however you want to play with them. But know that at any time, if you find a limiting belief or a judgment coming forward for you that you want to release, take it to your plane and set it a sail. Namaste.
play again. Oh, sitting on the dock of the bay, watching the tide roll away. Sitting on the dock of the bay, wasting time. Left my home in Georgia, headed for the Frisco Bay. 'Cause I got nothing to live for. Looks like nothing gonna come my way. Yeah. I'm sitting on the dock of the bay, watching the tide roll. Dock of the bay, wasting time. Oh, watching the tide roll away, yeah. Just sitting on the dock of the bay, wasting time. One last time.
So, just a quick question. How many of you love to dance? How many of you love to dance but don't think you can dance? How many are just terrified to dance? Such a liar, Reggie. You know, I think about that song, and what comes up for me in that song is the idea of doing nothing or just kind of hanging out. Sometimes it brings up a lot for folks, like, I shouldn't be doing this. And Tori, I'm going to ask you to move to my left, because it's just not going to work for you right there. She has a hurt shoulder, so a little bit of help there. Thank you. Three buddies die in a car crash. And they're up in heaven, and they're having an orientation. And they're informed that they all have the opportunity to be present during their funeral. And the orientation angel, because there is one, asks each of them, when you're in the casket and friends and family are mourning your passing, what would you like them to hear say about you? And so they're sitting there thinking, the first guy says, wow. You know, I would just like to hear him say I was a good friend and a great family man and just very dedicated to the people I love. And the second guy says, I'd like to hear that I was a wonderful partner and a school teacher who made a big difference in kids' lives. And the third guy, he thinks for a minute and he replies and he says, I would like to hear them say, oh my gosh, he's moving. Yeah. You know, it's interesting, but a lot of times what we think about is so serious and so much about what we think we should be. And to play, so you probably noticed I don't have an issue with dancing in front of people. I could have been a pole dancer for that matter. I could have, and I'd have no issue with it, but I just don't have that skill. And the reason I say that is because the one time I stop thinking about what I'm, whether I'm doing it right or what you're thinking about my dancing, because I really don't care, is when I'm dancing. It's a form of play that I miss tremendously. And I remember when I was first thinking about being a minister, and I don't watch the Ellen show, and I think it's off now, is that correct? Or is it still on? Is it still on? But I used to watch Ellen dance, and I used to get a lot of joy out of that because that's what I wanted to be in my own way. Because I know why she dances in my mind. It's because she finds a lot of joy in it, and she loves to encourage other people. So when I'm standing in front of you encouraging you, it's because I have such joy in it. And Ray, I know that I didn't let you say no, but part of that was because I've always wanted to dance with you. And what's really interesting about play for me is when I was, this is so teenage girl, what I'm about to tell you. When I was about 13, it wasn't just teenage girl, but there certainly was an element of it. I was so angry at my parents, and not because I was just a teenage girl. I actually had a right to be pretty ticked off at them. And my dad was a great playmate. Like, he would go out, and he set up in our driveway. We lived in a tiny town that looked like a Stephen King novel, just saying. But in our driveway, he had set up a place for us to set up poles because I was a volleyball player and we could have a volleyball court in the driveway. He also had a basketball set up, and then when he worked a lot, but when he wasn't working and he wasn't completely exhausted, he would come out and play with us. And he would come out and play volleyball, he would come out and play basketball. My dad always encouraged me to play because I loved being an athlete. I loved moving my body like that, especially when I knew what I was doing. And I struggled when I didn't. I struggled because I was incredibly self-judgmental about whether I could do something right or not. But play was not one of those things. And so when I played with my dad, it was just a lot of fun. And then with what was going on in my household, which was pretty traumatic, I told my dad, I'm not playing with you anymore. Because I felt to play with me, I'm going to let this plane go over. You know they're partying because they're going to land. So I stopped playing with my father. Sounds like a movie, doesn't it? I think it's in a movie somewhere. I stopped playing and I refused to play with him because I didn't believe he deserved to play with me. And I did that for years, and then I realized, you know, as I got older and went through certain things, as I got together with family, that I had this thing about playing in family. And so I had to heal that. Each one of us, whenever we stop ourselves from playing, it's something within us that is answering or being invited to be healed. So I'm going to ask you a question. So when I play, substitute you as I, when I play, what does it feel like? When I really play, so tell me what it feels like. Joyful.
Joyful. Release.
Freedom.
Alive.
Anything else?
Unrestricted.
Unrestricted.
Creative.
Creative.
Expressive.
Expressive. Happy. Now, what's interesting about play is, and I'm going to interject that, because play for me became competitive because I was an athlete. So the thing I loved most, like I loved volleyball, and I played volleyball through most of my adult life so far. it became competitive because that's what happens sometimes. But I started to play with a volleyball group about 3 years ago. And what I noticed in this group is, as competitive as they were competitive in a very playful way. And if you had any judgment about your own play, it didn't work in the group. You had to be able to take some teasing that was, you know, very, it wasn't, I would say, negative teasing, but just encouragement. And as athletes do, we call it trash talk sometimes, which is encouraging each other. It was when it didn't get to a point of when there was something behind it to minimize another. As long as we stayed away from that. And I missed that in the last year and a half. I haven't gotten to play. I've got to play a couple times, but the group hasn't come back together because of the current global situation. And I really missed it because I found that those 2 days a week that I was playing volleyball with my friends, there's a difference. There's a group playing there, but I don't feel a connection with them. It doesn't feel like play to me. It feels like I'm competing. With my friends, it felt like we were really playing. And I really missed that play. And I found in the last year and a half that my play has been a bit absent. Anyone else feel that way? That it's been a little bit absent over the last year and a half? The things that I typically would do, I can't do. And so what did I do? I shut down my play as if, and so here's how it works. If I can't do that, I can't play because that's what I like to do. So it's like I almost eliminated that idea of play. And when I say play, I'm not talking about working out. I'm not talking about getting exercise. I'm talking about the joy of really having that space. Because when you play, in a spiritual principle standpoint, when you play, you're actually incredibly present. Why are you really present? Because you're not thinking. You're just in the moment. At the simplest level, play, spiritually speaking, is presence. It's feeling the spaciousness and it's having joy. When I'm playing, I'm in the present moment, I'm inspired in my play, inspired to open up more, inspired to step out of what's typically, I limit myself because I'm thinking too much. But when I play, really play, for me, like dancing, and I knew Nikki's that way too, which was easy. I said, Nikki, will you dance with me? And she's like, oh yeah, sure. You know, like that's like asking Nikki to bake or, you know, to smile. You know, it's just part of who she is, right? And she finds a lot of joy in that. I find that joy too, because again, I can be so present. I can look you in the eye, whether you're dancing or not, and I can just be in that place of love and presence. Ernest Holmes said, there is an ever pressing against us, this dynamic force. There's this ever pressing against us, the dynamic force, that which paints the sunset, causes the soft glow of the evening twilight, sings in the bird, plays in the child, and proclaims itself at the level of our recognition of it. Every person is an outlet for the divine. What's really, what I found to be, and so when I was away for that beautiful month, what I found is I got to experience nature and see it play in creativity, divine creativity. And, you know, nature doesn't ask permission. It doesn't care. The tree will leaf. Flowers will bloom. It doesn't matter whether you think it, whether you judge it or not. It does it. The difference between those species and us is we have this consciousness that is self-conscious. We have something within us that says, oh, that won't look right, or I can't do that well, or, and I'll even give you this. Over the last year and a half, I've experienced depression. I'm not a depressed person per se, but I've had moments where I've felt depressed, because I just didn't know what to do in the world. And I didn't know what was, you know, how, in sort of as a minister in senses, for that year of speaking into a camera, I thought, is this the way it's going to be sometimes? Which really kind of puts a press down on your creativity to think that this is the way it's going to be. When you're in creativity, you don't think about that. And that's why it's really, really important to play. Because when I play, and I'm going to qualify the play, not to the expense of your life, though, not to escape. Play is not an escape. Sometimes play is a step away so I can get out of my head, but not as a continuous escape, which is what I thought my dad was doing, which is why I was so angry. I thought he was just escaping, and therefore that I was a playmate, not that I was his daughter. And that was sort of my thinking at the time. Brené Brown says that stillness is not about focusing on nothingness. It's about creating a clearing. It's opening up an emotionally clutter-free space and allowing ourselves to think, to feel and think, and dream and question. That's in the Gifts of Imperfection. Whatever we think about play, if I'm struggling with something right now, how many of you, when you're really struggling, play is the last thing I want to do? Yeah. When I'm sad, play is not what I want to do. When I'm struggling with something, play is not what I want to do. And that's the tough part. So if I'm stuck in something, you know, what do I do? And I'm going to give you a little tool at the end today so you can kind of pull yourself out of that space you're in and open up to the possibility, because play is a way out. Play is a way out of depression. Play is a way out of being stuck. So let's do this. So when you have a belief about something and it's not a good one, it's about yourself or about another person, it's usually centered around an event, situation, or circumstance, right? Something happened, whether it's something that's happened and I have a belief about myself, something's happened in my experience with another, so I have a belief about them, or I have a belief about the entire relationship. It's usually about people, right? Or myself. Now, Tori and I were having this talk the other day, which I loved. I think it was yesterday, wasn't it, Tori? I was giving her my talk yesterday. Careful when you call me on a Saturday. The sun shines, and it has light to it, doesn't it? And there's a couple things about the sun that we say all the time that are truths for us. So, for example, the sun shines is a truth to us, but it's not exactly accurate. So, the sun sets. There's a truth to it, but it's not accurate. So tell me why that's not accurate, that the sun sets. Somebody have an idea? So we're doing this. We're doing this, right? So it's not really setting, is it? Now, it's our truth culturally, but it's not accurate. That is the truth for every story you have about yourself. It may be true because you've accepted it, but it is not accurate. And so often we accept things and we say, for example, I can't play, or I'm too afraid to do that. And that's true because we believe it, but it is not accurate. The thing about the sun is it's a really, it's a great metaphor for God and who we are. The sun is warm. And I could say warm because I'm far enough away, right? The closer I get, it gets a little hotter. There are rays that come off the sun, and some of that is radioactive, which is why we have this beautiful planet we live on that protects us from the radioactive rays of the sun. Now, God is very much like the sun, and we are very much the rays of the sun. So let me ask you this about the sun. Are the rays part of the sun? Yes, but they're not the sun, correct? But they're part of it. Is the warmth part of the sun? Even the radioactivity is part of the sun, but it is not the sun. So in the case of who we are not God, but we are the rays or the creation that is God. There is a creative nature of God that is playful. It plays in creation. Look at how many different trees are around us. Look at each one of us here and how different each one of us look. Just because it's different doesn't mean it isn't part of it. But what's interesting about when you think about God is there is this multiplicity in the creation of God. So everything is God. Everything is part of it, but it isn't God. But it's all part of it. All has the same things of it. And how God or the universe or spirit plays is through creation. And it doesn't create something unless it has joy in it. It only creates that which it is. When we play without really knowing it, there's a reverence in playing when we really play. Because the only thing we're doing is we're in the moment, and that's reverence. Matthew Fox says, sharing our experiences of awe will lead to an experience of reverence. In allowing one's authentic awe and wonder to be born again, in welcoming the pure, the child, and the playfulness to come to self-expression, one is involved in co-creation, for there is no creation without play. We can't create, not really create the life that we want, unless we can play. We often, as I know Nikki talked about, the fact that being childlike is what we have, we believe in our mind, what we relate to is the last time I played with abandonment was probably when, might have been when I was a child. And that's unfortunate because children don't own that. They just, we forget about it as we get older. It becomes responsibility. It becomes about whether I'm good enough or not, or whatever those things are. To play, it allows us to when we play, to see the amazing things in nature, including how that huge thing can fly. Isn't that amazing? It's like, it's beyond my capacity to understand with respect to physics, but the fact is the things around us, there's always things around us to remind us of how amazing life is. Now, in Hinduism, there is this thing called Leela. And Leela is called divine play. And in Hinduism, gods embody the principles that teach its followers about enlightenment. And true play is a form of enlightenment. So when you're really in play, you are in enlightenment. It's not a destination, it's an activity. Gods are believed to be complete with no needs or desires. True play has no need or desire. Nothing. It's just to be in that beautiful moment. To resemble the gods, one must stop acting from necessity and act outside of cause and effect. So I'm going to ask you to go back to your childhood when you were playing as a child. And was there the kid in the room that had to have the rules? Now, I'm not saying there's a board game and all of a sudden you can't follow the rules. That's not the point, because there's always that. But when you were out playing and you were imagining, there was a kid that says, oh, no, you can't do that. Oh, no, you can't do that, right? That's not the rules. And there are some of us that have decided that there are rules to play, which there might be, such as be kind to one another and those kinds of things, but that's just part of living and being human. But when I can't play without some kind of rule or need or cause, Reggie, I want you to watch that for me, okay? Okay. When I can't do that, I'm acting from a place that is what we call the illusion. Every time you're not present, see, now you're in awe. Every time that you aren't present, you have placed some demand or requirement on yourself and others, which is the illusion. The illusion. Doesn't matter what it is. And it either always is or it isn't. It's always true. So in Hinduism, the creative process and the action of Leela is real, and the creation is the manifestation of the true nature of God. So freedom and spirituality, enlightenment, all come down to the ability to be very present, which is play. Which is play. Now, the thing that creative people have found, and when I say creative people, I mean every one of you, is that if I don't play, I am stuck in old ideas. However, if I feel stuck, the best thing I can do, and every neuroscientist will tell you this, the best thing to do is to step away from what I'm doing and play. The problem is, and here's the challenge we all get into, I get stuck in it and I stay there, and the story gets to be true, and it's playing out now in my head, and now I'm believing it, now I'm living out my story again, which means I can't play. So the trick is to try to catch, or the challenge is to catch myself before I am so living up here in the penthouse. Because by the way, when we say that the mind is creative, it's not this thing. It's not the brain. What's creative is consciousness. And we are not our brains. Our brains are part of our bodies, and our brains are here to protect us from the tiger at the door, to which there is none. There is no tiger at the door. Therefore, the brain is a tool, but it should not be driving. It should not be driving. So, joyful creation is the divine play, being present and allowing ourselves to be aware. And when we're playing, we're doing exactly what Ernest Holmes talks about when he's talking about the formless and the form. If I want to manifest, I have to manifest from the formless, which is an idea. And that idea has to be, when I'm not attached, something already out here, something that's already in form. If it's a relationship that you're struggling with, you got to move out of that relationship and my idea of the relationship and move into formless. The best way to do it is to step out of the story. Now, I'm going to teach you something real quick that's really easy to do. Whenever you're troubled and you feel like you just can't step out of it. So I want you to, there it is, Reggie, I told you it was going to happen. It was that divine idea. So, for just a moment, you can either close your eyes or keep your eyes open. It really just depends on you. I want you to just take yourself, and I want you to put yourself in your body. And I just want you to feel your body. If you have some pain, which you might have, and I know that's true, don't go to the pain part of your body, because that we tend to do that. Go to the part of your body that feels vast within you. Just feel the part of your body, and every time you start to think, did you start to think? I want you to go, okay, I'm just going to put that thinking aside. I'm going to go back into my body. And you're just going to feel the aliveness in your body. And you have to just, every time you start to think, you're no longer present, by the way. You're in the past. We're trying to get you present. So just feel something in your body. And if you're not sure where to go in your body, feel your hands. And just put your hands out like this. And let me ask you something. Can you feel some tingling in your hands? Yes? No? Maybe? It doesn't. Don't think it's nothing. If you feel that tingling in your hands, that's your aliveness. That's your aliveness. So just feel that. And if you feel it, now if you went like this, so look at me, you went like this and then you went here, come back to your hands. Because you know you did that. There was at least two or three of you that went right back up your head going, gee, I need a manicure. Valerie did that one. I'm just kidding, Valerie. Or I could use some lotion. Or what is she talking about, right? The moment you start to think, you're not present. And if you want to get out of a place that you're in, that's what you can do. So as we go forward, so here's my assignment for you. I don't always give assignments, but I'm giving an assignment this Sunday, okay? One, if you struggle with play, then this is what I want you to do. I want you to notice others playing. And when you start to judge that play, I want you to notice that you're judging that play. And just step out of the judgment and feel into the play. So I'm just going to ask for a show of hands, because I might check in with you. I might not, but I might. How many of you struggle playing? Okay. Yeah, okay. So today, which is Sunday, right? Beautiful day. Here we are in a park. By the way, I find it interesting. There's soccer in the park. If you have any judgment about any of it, just put it away. Watch people play. I saw people drop in there with their bikes, cruising by going, what are they doing? The little boy that was whose parents were running him around the park to wear him out, I'm sure. How sweet. He was just so loving running around the park. It's not about the play itself. It's notice the action in that play. Notice how beautiful that play is. And don't be afraid this week to just do that. And then the second thing I'd like you to do is I want you to do one thing of play this week, and I don't care what it is, and I'm going to ask you not to do it on your phone. Because the phone is busyness, and the phone is a way to escape, but it's really not play. It's not, and we know that. So do something. I don't care what it is, whether it's to walk around the block and just notice the flowers. Whatever it is, do it for no reason except to be present in your life. Okay? Okay. So here's what we're going to do. I'm going to change a little bit up today. I'm looking at my... Okay. Kong, I'm going to ask you to come up and go ahead and play some music. And then after he plays, we're going to do the conscious giving, and I'm going to do prayer. So while he's doing this, I want you to think about prayer you want this week for play. Okay? So just let me rephrase that. Stop thinking about what you want and feel into what you want and see what Spirit tells you. And then when I go to prayer, we'll just hold that prayer for whatever it is that you feel. And I know you may have family member that needs prayer. No, not today. If you want that, please talk to one of our practitioners afterwards. This is for you. This is just for you. Okay?
Gonna lay down my burdens down by the riverside. I'm gonna lay down my burdens down by the riverside. I'm gonna lay down my burdens, study war no more. Study war no more. Study war no more. Study riverside, singing, down by the riverside, yeah. Down by the riverside, gonna stick my sword in the golden sand. Down by the riverside, down by the riverside, down by the riverside. Study war no more, study war no more. Ain't gonna study war no more, yeah. Ain't gonna study war no more, study war no more. Ain't gonna study war no more. Down by the riverside, gonna put on my long white robe. Down by the riverside, down by the riverside, down by
by the riverside, gonna lay my burdens down. Down by the riverside, down by the riverside, down by the riverside, gonna lay my burdens down. Down by the riverside, ain't studying war no more. Ain't gonna study war no more. Down by the riverside, down by the riverside, down by the riverside, gonna lay my burdens down. Down by the riverside, study war no more. Woo!
So one quick story. You ready? Thank you, Valerie. I'm no longer scared of these. Remember that? Flying cow. So yesterday, I'm going on a backpacking trip, 8 days at the end of the month. Woo-hoo! I was a little nervous, and now I'm not. I'm really glad for that. But I was sitting with Kristen Hawkins and her wife, Deborah Scanlon, yesterday, and we were planning and we were talking. And as we're sitting there, I'm hearing this sound kind of either next door, and it's somebody moaning. And I'm listening to it, and I'm thinking, are they okay? And I turned to her and I said, they're having sex, aren't they? And she's like, well, it sure sounds like it. And we listen, and it kept going, and she goes, wow, she's having a really good time. Church, but different people. Yeah, it's absolutely true. So the deal is this, is play. Whatever that looks like, play. And just have that experience this week. So what for prayer would you like? And I'm going to write it down. So tell me what it is.
Release.
Release. Joy. Hey, Janet. Good to see that face.
Whoops.
No judgment. So what would no judgment look like on the sort of...
Whatever you're doing, don't judge that you shouldn't be doing it. Or...
How about being open?
Okay, that sounds good.
Would that work? Play time with your wife this week?
Way too far.
So, Paulette, I'm just telling you, it's Jackie. Be open, get ready.
Be in the moment.
Give it all.
Chuck?
Acceptance.
Acceptance, got it. Ray, did you have something? Let it go?
Let it go.
How about you, Terry? I heard you.
Give it all.
Give it all. Okay, watch out, Ray. Give it all.
Fully present.
So
I want to be able to experience all of my life.
You should. So it sounds like, if I may ask, so she wants to be able to get it all done and still have that space of play, which means that there might be a little worry that you don't have enough time, or that...
I want the awareness to stay in that.
That sounds like a recognition, aware. Okay.
Yeah.
Of course you will.
Coming up with me permission to play. And so, but I think it might lead into that, like, I think it's like a lot of time to play. I think that it's a care responsibility sometimes.
So funny too, Valerie, because I think of you as the epitome of play. Is anybody else? See? I don't know. Not a competition. So right now is the time of our conscious giving. So you get, I'm going to ask our welcome team who left.
What'd you need?
My welcome team left.
What would you like?
Basket? So I'm going to call Reggie later and ask him what he went to play with.
He'll be right back.
He'll be right back.
He'll be right back.
Okay.
He's taking an intermission.
Or you want me to go around?
Just put it right there in the middle. Thanks, Jackie.
Near me.
So, yeah, put it near Terry. And somebody watch Terry. Okay. So, here's what I know. What I know is that at this time of conscious giving, what I'm going to give is from that place of play. Whether you give online or you give, you know, in sort of a more, I would say more conscious way, but more physically present way, which is I'm going to give to this community that gives to me. This community that was formed from the bones of being radically inclusive, which is play. Knowing that each person here is that emanation, is that incarnation, that expression, that breath of God. For all creation is the breath of God. That God is all there is, and there is only the power and presence of God that exists, and it exists in everything, not just the things I've called God, but everything. So what I know for everyone in this community is this. That right here and right now, there is a little release happening right here, that whatever is in the way of my play, I let go. So say that with me. I let go. That there is joy in play, and that every time I think about play, I think joy. I think joy. And then I am open to that play and to the possibility. I'm just going to warn you that when you say that, it's going to show up and it's going to be your choice to say yes or no. So right here and right now, you're going to say with me, I'm open to play. I am open to play. I accept any opportunity to play.
I accept any opportunity to play.
As Emma Curtis Hopkins would say, but I deny escaping with play. Right. And that there is peace in play.
There is peace in play.
And that I am present when I play.
I am present when I play.
And I let go of anything in the way of that play.
I let go of anything in the way of that play.
And when I play, I give it all.
When I play, I give it all.
And that I am present.
I am present.
I am aware.
I am aware.
And I absolutely give my permission to play.
Absolutely give my permission to play.
So in that abundant mind that is the mind of God, I accept this covenant. I accept this covenant.
I accept this covenant.
Careful what you say.
I accept this covenant.
So therefore, in beautiful gratitude for the gift of giving that you've already given today, and the gift that you continue to give to this community as yourself for you, as me for me, I just accept the generosity and abundance and call it good and very good. And so it is. Amen. Thank you for coming to join us in the park today. I think we have a benediction somewhere. So if, come over here, Sean, and stand right next to this table and face that way and be Vanna for the moment. Poor Vanna. Poor Vanna.
Poor Vanna? Everybody knows who Vanna is.
She's not poor.
She's not poor. Okay, so will you stand if you are able? And for those of you that struggle standing, we'll give you a little moment. That was very playful.
I hate that.
So, I want you to, let's do whatever Terry's doing today, okay? So Terry, you're in charge during the benediction. Whatever you do, they have to do. Okay, you're gonna play this game with me? You ready, Terry?
Yes.
All right, so we know that we are life, right?
Yes.
Do we know this? Uh-oh, he's stretching. So I know that something's happening. So will you tell me what is happening? I've said you have to do whatever Terry does. You don't have to jump, but you got to move. Something wonderful is happening through me right now. Hold on. What is it? Called life. Where's life?
Life is in my body.
Hold on. This is the big one. Oh. Life is all that I am. Life is all that we are. Hold on again, because there's something I'm going to do with it, right? What am I going to do? I accept it. I am it. Now, we're going to share it with Terry, but I want you to do whatever Terry does right now, because he's going to share it with who, Terry? I share it with all. Now, how do I do that? Do I have a disclaimer on it? Do I have an exemption to it, Kong? No. Just the way it appears, and just the way it appears not. I need a phone here for a picture. So keep going, Terry, because... Crazy Terry. Thank you, Terry. Just the way it appears, just the way it appears not. Now tell me this. What's the most grateful thing you can do today? Is to say what?
Thank you, life.
Way to go. So if you know this, sing this with Colin. Don't be afraid. Give it all you've got. You've said that's the prayer. Thanks, everyone. Have a great week and make sure you play. Woo!